Hey guys, welcome back to 4M Training. We are delighted that you're with us. We have been studying over these last few series together the concept and the idea of laying down some of the fundamental principles you need in order to live out the godly life. Things like scripture memory and Bible study and prayer and walking in the Spirit. But for the next several lessons, we're going to engage in taking all of those truths and applying them to some of the things we struggle with. Things like anxiety, procrastination, self-pity, sexual temptation, and anger. And as we do that, you're going to get a chance to see firsthand how the Word of God works in these areas of our life. So today we're going to take a big one. We're going to start with one of the larger issues that most people struggle with, and that's the issue of anxiety. And most people didn't realize the Bible actually uses that word in multiple places and gives them hope and encouragement. So we want to apply those truths, dig into the scriptures, and find out how we're going to live lives in an anxiety-free zone. So here's the first couple things I want you to look at. You'll notice that the first idea is found in 1 Peter chapter 5, verses 6 through 8. And there we read, "Humble yourselves, therefore, under the mighty hand of God, that he may exalt you at that proper time, casting all your anxieties on him, because he cares for you. Be sober-minded, be watchful. Your adversary, the devil, prowls around like a roaring lion, seeking someone to devour." Now think about this with me for a moment. The first idea with anxiety found in the scriptures is that you're going to have to believe the word, not your feelings. There's several truths in here that are easy to miss. Here's the first one. It may not feel like pride, but it is. Notice how this passage on anxiety and casting our cares on the Lord starts with the simple phrase, "Humble yourselves." When we're struggling with anxiety, we're thinking it all depends on us. The Bible is clear. Humble yourself. It may not feel like pride, but it is. Here's the second idea. The scripture says, casting all your anxieties on him because he cares for you. The second idea is captured with this thought. It may not feel like God cares, but he does. When we're struggling with anxious thoughts due to our circumstances, it's easy to say, if God really cared, I wouldn't be feeling this way. But notice what the text says, because he cares for you. It may not feel like God cares, but he does, so you'll need to trust him. And finally, note this. We're warned in verse 8 to be sober-minded and be watchful. It may not feel like these thoughts are dangerous, but they will be. If I were to tell you that a roaring lion was seeking to come into the room right now, you'd be really sober-minded and you'd be really watchful. And yet, when we think anxious thoughts over and over and over again, we tend to find out that those thoughts become dangerous thoughts to us before very long. Before long, we can't seem to think thoughts without those anxious thoughts coming back. Believe the word, not your feelings. Here's the second idea we want to look at. We're captured by this thought that we want to change our mind, not our circumstances. Notice with me in that passage in Philippians that we find one of the best passages in the Bible to how to handle anxious thoughts. Philippians chapter 4, and there we read, "Be anxious, do not be anxious about anything," or some translations render it, "Be anxious for nothing." The first thing you want to change with your mind, because you can't change your circumstances, is that you want to learn to change how you think about worry. There's different ways that the Greek language captures the actions in the scriptures. And one of the ways it does that is through this idea of a command, or the Greek language would capture it in the form of an imperative. That is something that God is telling us to do. It's not optional. Here it is. God says, be anxious for nothing. That's a command. God commands us not to. When we do, we sin. So you want to change how you think about worry. You also want to change how you think about prayer. Notice the text there. We read, again, in Philippians chapter 4, verse 6. We capture it this way. "The Lord is at hand. Do not be anxious about anything, but in everything, by prayer and supplication with thanksgiving, let your requests be made known to God." Notice that we want to see prayer as a pattern, not a panic button. If you're praying about anxious thoughts or things that circumstances that makes you anxious, it's typical that you would jump right to that thought. But that's not how this describes prayer. It says, first of all, pray for everything, both the small things and the large things. Nothing is too small that God's not interested. Nothing is too large that God can't handle it. The next word is the word supplication, which is a word that speaks of our neediness. Acknowledge you are needy before the Lord. And then a fascinating word in the text, thanksgiving. We're not even to the request yet, and we are reminded to be thankful. In everything, by prayer and supplication with thanksgiving, let your requests be made known to God. Create a thanksgiving list in your prayer time. Notice, you're developing a pattern. You're not simply reaching for prayer as a panic button. You want to change how you think about prayer. And then finally, you'll notice this in Philippians chapter 4, verse 8. Finally, brothers, whatever is true, whatever is honorable, whatever is just, whatever is pure, whatever is lovely, whatever is commendable, if there is any excellence, if there is anything worthy of praise, think on these things. There's 8 qualities there that we're reminded about how we are to think. You want to change how you think. It's your mind. You're responsible to control it. I love the word responsible. You can hear 2 words in it. Response able. You are response able to control your mind. So you want to change your mind because you can't change your circumstances regarding anxiety or worry. Change how you think about it. Change how you think about prayer. And then change how you think. It's your mind. See these 8 qualities in Philippians 4:8, as parameters on your thought life. They're the way that you should be thinking. And if the thought isn't true, if it's a what if or an if only idea, then you don't know definitely that it's true. So don't spend your time anxiously worrying about it. Learn to think thoughts within what I call the Philippians 4:8 think list. And then there's one final thought for us as well. You need to desire God, not simply relief from anxiety. There's a wonderful passage in Psalm 37 that starts out with this, "Don't worry about the wicked or envy those who do wrong." And in verse 7, it ends kind of the same way. Don't worry about evil people who prosper or fret or worry about their wicked schemes. But with those 2 ideas as bookends, the middle of that passage gives us the idea for how we ought to desire God more than simply relief from anxiety. We find in verse 4 this command, take delight in the Lord. And in the very next verse, verse 5, commit everything you do to the Lord. Trust Him and He will help you. And finally, verse 7, be still in the presence of the Lord and wait patiently for Him to act. It's a great reminder that if we take delight in God, then we will find that we can be still in the presence of the Lord. Most often when we struggle with anxiety, and this applies to dads and other men as well, we are thinking that all we want is relief from the anxiety. Don't think about it that way. Look at these passages and remember, 1 Peter 5 reminds us very clearly that we need to change how we think about anxiety. And we find in Psalm 37 that we want to desire God, not simply relief from the anxiety. And Philippians 4, verse 6 through 8, finally reminds us that when we change our thought processes, we're able to think more clearly about how we should pray and how we can trust God as we're changing the way that we're thinking. Now take a look at your next section, if you will, the Minister Inside and Out page, as your small group leader is going to lead you in this discussion. And can I just encourage you? You've been together now for several weeks, so this is a great opportunity to be transparent if you have struggles or difficulties with worry or anxiety. Share some of those things in your group, and may God bless you as you grow together.